Hey everybody, we're gonna get started in a few minutes. We're just gonna listen to some music.
We don't talk about Bruno, no, no, no. We don't talk about Bruno. But it was my wedding day.
It was our wedding day.
We were getting ready and there wasn't a cloud in the sky.
No, oh, Rock likes this.
Bruno says it looks like rain.
Where's the heat alone?
In doing so, he floods my brain.
Abuela gets the umbrella.
Pouring in a hurricane.
What a joyous day, but anyway.
We don't talk about Bruno.
No, 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 no. We don't talk about Bruno.
Hey, Bruno live in fear. Bruno's stuttering or stumbling. I can always hear him sort of muttering and mumbling. I associate him with the sound of falling sand.
Till last night, so don't feel bad if you've never heard this song before.
Told me that my power would so grow like the grapes that thrive on the vine.
Oye, Mariano's on his
he
way.
Told me that the man of my dreams would be just out of reach. Betrothed to another, it's like I hear him.
Hey, sis.
I want not
it's
a
like
sound out of
him.
You.
Great choice to start us off, Triss. Welcome everybody in. We're at bonfire number 8, just 3 more bonfires left in your fellowship. Tonight, we're gonna talk about housing innovation. We are so, so lucky to be joined by Drisana Hughes. She is an original member of the CU family. She was with us at the beginning when we started CU over 2 years ago. She is a jack of all trades, is a financial expert, political expert. She's run political campaigns, very, very successful in many different endeavors. So we are so lucky to have her here. How are you doing tonight, Driss?
I'm doing good. I'm a little upset that I can't talk about Bruno, but I'm happy to be here. I'm happy to be here and see everyone.
Perfect. So Driss is going to kick us off with a little icebreaker.
Okay, so I have a lot of thoughts on this because Nick showed it to me early, so I'm prepared, but take a second to think about a movie or a TV show that's better than the book it was based on. And think, you don't have to say the first thing that comes to your mind. There's a lot of ones that are based on books that you might forget. Almost all of the Disney movies are based off of books.
What's yours? Since you've thought about it already, I'm curious.
I feel a little fake saying this because I haven't read The Lord of the Rings, but the Lord of the Rings movies are absolutely incredible. So I was gonna say Lord of the Rings. Yeah. Oh,
so I think Game of Thrones. That's similar. I think Game of Thrones.
Oh, Game of Thrones. Yeah. Bridgerton, I didn't realize was a book. So thanks for saying that, Nicole. It makes me think. So Hunger Games, yes. That's a really good one too. I was waiting for the Harry Potters and I disagree with you guys, but it's neither here nor there. Queen's Gambit, that's a good one too.
Oh, that is a good one.
Howl's Moving Castle. Everyone has very good taste. You all have very good taste. We watch good movies and TV shows.
The Leo DiCaprio Gatsby, I don't know about that one.
These are amazing answers. Amazing ones. Ooh, Devil Wears Prada. I also didn't know that was a book. What a great question. I hope everyone's learning.
Oh, Coraline? I didn't know that was a book either.
Wow, that is a book. The movie's very good though, too. Yeah. That's a toughie, but they're both excellent. Yes, I'm with Alan. I'm still on Devil Wears Prada was a book. That is like...
it was a very successful book, yeah.
Yeah. Very cool.
Curious George.
Huh. I have to see the Curious George movie and get back to you on that one.
I have not seen that. Descendants. Wait, is that Breaking? Was Breaking Bad a book?
That's a book, is it?
I don't know if that was a book. I'd read it if it was.
No, there's no way.
Yeah, I don't think so. Forrest Gump. Was that a book?
Forrest Gump should be a book because it made me cry and it's a beautiful story. Jojo Rabbit.
Oh, I know. That's a good one.
I have to see that movie.
Just a couple more before we start, as I see a bunch of people typing.
And now I'm just realizing that I need to read more. So this is weirdly making me feel bad about myself. So I thought I was like, oh, I know all these things about movies, but
yeah. Of Mice and Men, that is a good movie.
That is a good one. That is a good one. And there's lots of versions of the movie.
Yes,
there's a few.
There is. That reminds me of Ant.
Pretty Little Liars. That's an underrated answer. I'm going to heart that because I've read the books and seen the TV show. Yep, four hearts.
Have you ever seen the cartoon of Animal Farm that was done in like the 1950s or something?
I have not seen the cartoon version. That seems like a dark cartoon.
It's not good. It's not good. Yeah, that's one where the book is definitely better.
Yep. Cool. Well, we can do this for 30 minutes.
I know. Thank you so much for all your responses. We're going to get to tonight's lesson. Andrew's going to start us off.
Sure. So here are some facts about housing in the United States before we get into our really, really amazing case studies that we want to help set the tone for you to understand why this is a problem that we have to think about solving creatively. So first, there's roughly 550,000 homeless people in the United States. And then there are also 17 million vacant homes in the United States. So you may see those two numbers and be like, what the heck? That doesn't make sense. That doesn't square away in my brain. And so we're going to talk about that through the whole lesson, but here are some initial reasons why that's not as simple as it seems. Why don't we just put these 550,000 people into some of these homes? One, there are less vacancies in metro areas where the majority of homeless people are. So, a lot of these vacant homes are in rural areas, areas that are way, way, way far away from homeless populations. So that means that people can't just go, you know, hop in and live in those homes. A lot of vacant houses are second homes. So there are people that own those houses. Maybe they don't want anyone living in the houses when they're not there. So they're empty, but that doesn't mean we can just put people in there. Many houses are only temporarily vacant because someone's doing a repair, because someone's building a new building, because people are moving out and moving in. And so that inflates the number. Many are in disrepair or unlivable. So there's lots of things, you know, we have new laws that make you change, you know, how houses are built. There's huge swaths in New York City that had asbestos in their buildings, which are killing people. So we can't move into any of those buildings anymore. And many are up for rent. So that's why, even though we have 17 million vacant homes, we still need to build more houses, even though it seems like, you know, there might be a lot of space for folks already.
Yeah. And so you might be wondering then, well, what about renting? Is that kind of the solution to this? And it's interesting that 60 Minutes, a news program in the US, just did a story about the skyrocketing rent prices in the US. That goes for renting a whole house or just renting an apartment. In just 1 year, in the last year, rents have risen 30% in Jacksonville, a city in Florida, a growing city in Florida, 35% here in New York City, and 40% in Austin, Texas. So really, really sharp increase in the cost of renting. You're probably wondering, you know, what's causing this? First, is the lack of housing supply. Even though, like we said, there's 17 million vacant homes, we are not building enough homes to keep up with demand. We've actually built fewer houses and apartments in the last 12 years than we did all the way back since the 1960s. Now, demand for housing is rising at the same time. And that's because people from our generation, millennials, originally weren't buying houses during 2008 through kind of 2015. But now they do want to buy homes, and there's this big appetite and demand for them. So it's going to take about 4 million more homes and apartments to satisfy this demand and start to stabilize these prices. There is one other big factor in this, and it's that big corporations have been buying up homes and renting them for sky-high prices. That's happening a lot, especially in southern cities in the United States. There are tons of companies that do this. I just put one in here called Tricon Residential as an example. You can check them out. But they've been very successful at buying up these homes that would normally just go to individuals and then turning around and renting them to people at sky high prices. They've done so well. Their stock price has been up 60% in the past year. So that means they're probably going to keep doing that. Their investors probably like making that money. And so we're going to see more and more corporations buying up houses, which means that people can't own them. And instead, they might be renting for their entire lives. You can see this problem illustrated on this graph here. The blue line is the supply of housing in the US. Look at how high it was from like 2005 through 2012. Every year it was increasing. Now we're on the downside. We're losing it. We need to build more housing. Conversely, prices are going up. They used to be much lower. They would be decreasing. Now, again, they've been skyrocketing since 2020. So if you have high prices and low supply, that is a problem. Okay, what are some other housing issues we may have missed here? I mean, if you don't live in the US, totally fine. What are the housing issues that you're seeing in your country? Okay, I see you redlining, apartments that are truly affordable. Such. Oh, that's you, Dres.
Sorry.
That's right. Houses being really small and damaged, more expensive houses than affordable housing. Yes. Mm-hmm. Lack of affordable housing. Yep.
My affordable housing crew is strong tonight.
Yeah. Credit scores for loans. Yeah. It can be really hard to get a loan if you do not have a high credit score. Gentrification. Yeah. We're going to be talking about gentrification tonight. Huge problem in Brazil is the insane interest rates in mortgages. Yes, the interest rates are rising in the US too. They were very low before, but now they're rising. Homes in the middle of the mountain that can collapse. That doesn't sound good. The down payments on houses, 100%. If a house requires 10, 15, 20% of the price down, that is very hard to come up with. Oh, houses not being adapted to climate change as well. Cheap construction, commercial expansion into residential areas. Houses built with poor materials. A lot of bad quality materials. Great. Thank you for all of these responses. So we're going to do our first case study in housing innovation. And it's a company called Kitswitch. And they're tackling the housing supply issue in a different way. First thing you need to know about Kitswitch is they are a small organization, 5 people, made up of architects, designers, and engineers. And they all happen to be women under 30. So they're cool, innovative, young company that's committed to sustainable, affordable housing by leveraging empty buildings, like empty offices. And you're probably wondering, how do they do this? Well, they're converting these vacant office buildings, vacant malls, vacant storefronts into apartments where people can actually live. Now that, of course, probably not that easy. They have to design what are called kit components to assemble affordable, sustainable, reconfigurable housing units within these vacant buildings. So basically, if the building has working plumbing, if they have running water in there, they can build a kitchen, a bathroom, and a bedroom, really the essentials for housing that you need. They can put that in almost any building as long as it has that infrastructure already of plumbing. And they do that by selling these kits. And that's what these pictures are. They're kind of like modular kits that can fit together in any way that is accessible in the building. So you can put like a sink, a stove, and a cabinet in any way, wherever it's needed in the building. It's a pretty cool concept, cool idea. They're not the only company that's doing something like this, trying to repurpose these empty buildings, but they are really innovative and worth checking out. If you're interested in doing a case study more on this, the link is here to the website. And you can probably actually email some of the founders and they would probably get back to you because they are pretty small still. So question for you is, do you see any downsides to this approach to housing? And are there any ways we could improve this concept? Ooh, first one, how do we prevent this from turning into basically the cage homes in Japan or Hong Kong? I don't know much. Do you know much about those homes, Driss?
No, but it kind of reminds me of like one thing I was writing is like, how do we prevent this from becoming like tenement housing and just like,
right,
you're going to very small locations and yes, it may be better than being homeless, but is this like a long-term solution for a family? Is this helping create pathways to ownership? So I don't know about those specific two examples, but I do know like tenement housing, which is, you know, really problematic, systematic housing that was in New York City for decades. They you're not allowed to build them anymore because you weren't able to live in a long-term humane way.
Right. It's one thing to have a kitchen, a bathroom, and a bedroom, but like, what does that really look like in practice? Yep. Does it feel like a livable situation for the long term? Why should we go for minimalism, especially for poorer families who should be cramped like a slum? Yeah, I think that's what Driss is getting at with this concern around tenement housing. Concerns about safety, right? Like some of these, like an office building isn't really designed for people to live in there year round. How are their HVAC systems, right? Like are they yeah, heated properly? Are they cooled properly if they haven't been in use for a long time?
Right. And like, I'm no architect, but I do assume the reason why you know what you're building before you start building the building is because it's a different infrastructure for a vacant office,
right,
than for something for lots of apartments. So safety is definitely a concern.
Yeah.
I think Eunice brings up a really good point, which is like, when we're talking about affordable housing, we're usually talking about families.
Right.
And so I love that the kits can quickly build things. But like, is this small sink gonna like feed my family of 5? Is this building gonna, is this little, you know, bathroom gonna handle?
Right. Yeah. Is there enough of an oven to handle cooking for a family, yeah, right? Instead of maybe just one person. Green engineering.
Yep.
yeah, these are all really good call outs about this idea. And one of the things that we ask you to do when you do a case brief and are looking at these case studies is critique it and criticize it, right? And come up with some valid points. Super valuable to engage in that. All right, we're gonna do another case study.
Cool. So the second case study we're doing is called the Housing Impact Fund, which I thought was very, very interesting. So the Housing Impact Fund is based in Charlotte, North Carolina, and they're committed to ensuring that affordable housing as it exists now stays affordable. So what they do is they actually buy affordable housing units, which sometimes are in terrible shape because they were made a long time ago by the government to be affordable housing units. They renovate them, but they say they're going to keep them at their prior price. So they've raised $58 million for this project, right? Like, in order to keep this at level, you need donations. So they've raised $58 million for it. And they've let investors know that they will make money, but they're only going to be capped at 8%, which that may still sound like a profit, but like the first company that Nick showed us on the slide, those people are making like 20, 30%. So with every property they buy, they also put a 20-year deed on it, which is what some of us were talking about with the prior thing. Like, this seems like these are really good long-term units that they're making. And 100% of these units are set aside for people earning less than the city's median in income. So this is the lower half of the city. They get these units. They're going to require that at least 80% of the rehabilitation work and construction work are done by minority contractors. So people who are not usually getting jobs necessarily compared to majority contractors. And what about after 20 years, right? This sounds super great. You give everyone these jobs for 20 years, then what happens after? They say any sales that you make after 20 years, you have to divert 60% of what you make to another fund that's doing the same thing and making sure that we keep affordable housing units affordable. So the fund managers are already looking at how can they do this outside of North Carolina? How can we keep affordable housing units affordable while improving them and not sell them to some massive corporation who's going to make a boatload of money? So now for this round, what do we think of this innovation? Could it work somewhere else? Is it just a North Carolina thing? And are there any downsides to it? Is there anything we see that doesn't seem quite right about the Housing Impact Fund?
I'll keep this up. Yeah. So people can look at those numbers.
And like read the fine details. Like, are there, like, how do we think that this could happen in New York City? Do we think this could happen in a bigger city than Charlotte? And what are some like things that seem like maybe they need to think this through a little more? I'm on the edge of my seat. Several people.
Yeah, I know. When several people are typing, you know it's going to be good.
I know.
I got tagged.
There you go. Nicole says it sounds self-sustaining. I agree. I do. I will say I like that they're thinking about the 20 years and all of that. Yeah. So, okay, this is a really good point by Kira, right? So where everyone's like, oh, great. Like, we're going to limit the profit. What if they can't raise money for the project?
Right.
What if no one wants to invest in the project now because you're capping what people can make? That is like an unfortunate reality of like raising money that we should all know. And then Benjamin's like, we don't want those people anyway. That's definitely true. And you know, we hope that we are, yesterday, Joe Biden just passed a new tax on billionaires. So this is incentivizing billionaires to spend more on this type of thing. And hopefully think about how to be charitable with their income. What does keeping it affordable mean? I think that's a good question. And I thought of this when I first looked at the slide. This goes to people earning less than the city's median income. What is the city's median income? What if in Charlotte, a lot of people have a lot of money? Is this really helping poor people? I don't know. What do you guys think? Jolene thinks it could happen in other cities. I think so too.
Mm-hmm.
But how does this last if people aren't making so much money off of it? Yeah, Zoe brings up a good point. Where is this, like, we're going to keep it up to code? Who's responsible for it? The Housing Impact Fund? Or the government? Like,
right.
Who's responsible for that? Yeah, and like, where does that money come from? That makes sure, like, I see where the money comes from to fix them and sell them, but where does the money come from? The upkeep of the building? Yeah, so I mean, to answer the question about lower income, because it's affordable housing, they can save it for people who are making below a certain income level. That's legal. But could those, you know, the medium income in New York City, we're talking almost $90,000 a year, which is not what you would consider United States poverty level. So maybe in a city, you know, where people make a lot of money, that's different than a city like Charlotte.
Right. Because I think countrywide, it's like 50 or 55,000 is medium income. Yeah. Right. So Charlotte's probably somewhere in between that and in New York City. So yeah, it's still going to be pretty high.
Right. Right. Yeah. So Alan brings up a good point. There's a lot of people moving out of London, Sao Paulo, New York. Especially, you know, after the pandemic, people moving, looking to live other places, this could help make cities still remain an attractive place to be. Kira's saying, are these good quality? I think because they're renovating them, my inclination when I look this up is that they're making them better than they currently are. So that we should assume they're getting better, but we don't know that they're staying that way for 20 years after. And so I think the quality question is a big one.
It is. Yeah, I would encourage people to read the article linked here too afterwards. You'll get some more of these details about that. These are awesome questions that you're getting at. The big question for me is the 20 years. 20 years actually goes by really quickly. I know it doesn't seem like it to our fellows who are under 20 years old, but it goes by pretty quickly. And then who knows what's going to happen when they turn over. I know they're going to give another 60% of the profits to another fund for affordable housing, but that's kind of just diluting it. What happens 20 years after that? Are they only going to give another 40%? And then it's kind of not really self-sustaining there. Awesome thoughts, everybody. Love how in-depth you've gone on this. And this is not an easy thing to understand. Like, this is like a pretty complicated financial structure that they've set up here. And this is real stuff. So I'm really impressed by everybody's thoughts on this.
Cool.
Okay. We're going to end the lesson tonight with a final thought. And I think some of you have brought this up already. You're probably wondering this. Doesn't building new housing just lead to gentrification? Like, isn't that what this is all leading to? And I'm going to argue not necessarily. New housing does not in itself equal gentrification. There's been a lot of studies done on this. Really cool video that's linked here from Vox shows that the way to solve the housing crisis is that we have to build new housing. There's no way around it. We need more housing in this country. And the kind of cookie cutter buildings that you might see in your cities that kind of all look the same, they're often derided as gentrification buildings. But the reason they're built in that cookie cutter structure is that they use affordable materials and they use affordable techniques, which can result in more affordable housing. These are not so-called luxury housing buildings. Now, what's also interesting is if you look back through history, the same criticisms of new buildings that were built in the mid-century, we often call those brownstones here in New York and in Brooklyn, those same criticisms were levied against those buildings when they were built in the 1940s and 1950s. And so we've always kind of derided these new buildings that go up that all look the same, but there's a reason for that. And sometimes they even become celebrated like brownstones now are. So even the building of market rate housing, so housing that is not deemed affordable housing, even the building of market rate housing has been found to not be a driver of the displacement of people already in the neighborhood. So building this market rate housing doesn't necessarily displace people by itself. And in fact, There's a study here that shows that building this market rate housing actually lowers the rents of other buildings nearby. Now, there's a caveat to that. Gentrification could still happen if there are not both affordable and market rate housing being built. So it can't just be market rate housing being built. You still need to be building just as much affordable housing. If you don't do that, then gentrification can happen. So the big question is, and this is kind of one of our big final thoughts, is why don't we just build more housing? It seems so obvious. We can build market rate housing, we can build affordable housing, we can build all kinds of housing. Wouldn't that just get us out of this mess? And it's not that simple. And that's because of what are known as zoning laws. We didn't touch on this tonight, but many places in the United States, and I'm sure places in your countries, they have zoning laws that prevent multifamily buildings, like large apartment buildings, from being built. And it's mostly in suburbs that we cannot build this kind of housing. And even cities have restrictions on where they can be built as well. There's a long history of zoning laws in the US, and it is beyond the scope of what we're talking about tonight. But I've linked an article here where you can learn more about how zoning laws have been used to entrench segregation, to keep the suburbs separate from cities. And they produce bad outcomes for almost everyone. And so there's a lot of really smart people that say that if you remove zoning laws and build, then a lot of our housing issues could be solved. So any thoughts from you, any final thoughts on this idea that building more housing is essential, about gentrification or about zoning laws? And Driss, you feel free too.
Angelina says, what is gentrification?
Yeah, so there's a difference between displacement and gentrification. So displacement means like people literally being displaced. So someone that has lived in a neighborhood for 20, 30, 40, 50 years, and they've been displaced from where they live because they can't afford that rent anymore. So people get displaced, but neighborhoods get gentrified. So people don't get gentrified. And gentrification means the neighborhood itself changes. The businesses that are there, the parks that are there, the culture that is there, that changes from what it used to be in the past to what it currently is or what it's evolving into. And it's generally a negative, there's a negative connotation associated with it. Do you want to add to that, Driss? I probably did a poor job explaining that.
Yeah, no. I think that makes a lot of sense. Like when people, when Nick means like negative connotation, like some people are like, I like my neighborhood the way it is and I don't want any gentrifiers coming in here. And what they mean by that is new people who didn't grow up there, who didn't experience the culture they experienced. However, neighborhoods changing is definitely also natural, as I'm sure everybody on this bonfire can say, you know, I remember on my street, there used to be this store and now there's a different store. There used to be this building and another one popped up. So it's really an analysis and an understanding of neighborhoods change and how do we do that with buy-in from the people who still live there. So they don't feel that things are changing without their consent. But it's a really complicated issue that's definitely really talked about where I live in New York, but I know it's something that folks talk about all around the world, how your block changes, how your neighborhoods change. I would encourage you all to think about like, how your neighborhoods have changed and if you what you like about it and what you didn't like about it. And those are things that housing folks need to be paying attention to. They need to pay attention to you and your families and folks before there's major changes to your neighborhoods. Yeah.
No, thank you for that. No, that's a great explanation. If you dive deeper into this stuff, you're gonna see a lot of terminology. One term that I forgot to mention is the term NIMBY, N-I-M-B-Y, that you come across a lot in this literature. So if any of you start reading this and you see that and you're wondering what does NIMBY mean? And it's an acronym for not in my backyard. And that kind of sums up what zoning laws are all about. there are many people who do not want new housing built in their backyard and in their neighborhood. They want to keep their neighborhood how it is and how it always has been. And they are very fearful and skeptical of building new housing. So they will say, you can build new housing over there, but not in my backyard, not where I live. And that's where the term NIMBY comes from. Someone who thinks the opposite and wants to allow new housing being built would be YIMBY, Y-I-M-B-Y. So just look out for those terms when you come across the literature. You'll see it in a lot of places.
So we have a question.
Yeah.
Which is, what do you think would be a solution when a community doesn't want a neighborhood or housing infrastructure to be changed?
Yeah, well, and that's the NIMBY position right there.
Yeah, and I think to wrap on that question is to say, you know, people have to organize themselves and you have to advocate for yourself, and, you know, things may go your way or not, but the worst thing you could do is stay home and tell no one. And that's why it's important to be civically engaged and know who your representatives are and know what your paths of recourse are, and things, you know, your neighbors might not agree with you and something might happen, and that's part of living in a group. But I would say being civically engaged and knowing the paths you have to redress your government or the folks making those decisions are important.
Yeah, there are some other questions in here. Also, remember, put your questions in the Q&A in Zoom, and we will answer them at the end. I'm looking at Nicole's question.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's absolutely a problem.
Definitely.
Yeah, you're not gonna get any debate from me, Nicole, on that. Education is the key to opening so many doors, right? If you don't even know how to, if you don't know why your house is, you know, making you sick or not correct or anything like that, it's really, really hard to redress that correctly. So we definitely, education is linked to everything.
All right, so some quick reminders. You can work on your Civic Innovators portfolio. Your two case studies are due at the end of the fellowship, which is rapidly approaching in about 3 weeks. I always put the instructions here for you. Remember, you have to submit them via the link that's down here. I also put this link in the syllabus and on the recap email, so you have plenty of places to find how to do your Civic Innovators portfolio. Our events this week, we got some really cool events. Tomorrow at 6:30, we have an international relations and urban planning session with Chabu and Luna. They are two experts on this area. They've been doing great work here. So if you're interested in IR or urban planning, please attend tomorrow's session. On Thursday, there's a community town hall. And then on Saturday at noon, we have the third session of The System with Nick Varney. If you're interested in systems thinking, which I know many of you are, I know these sessions have been well attended. You can always hop on. It's okay if you've missed the first two. He does a great job of getting people up to speed. And if you've attended before, I think you'll get a lot out of this one too. So Saturday at noon, that gives an opportunity for lots of people to participate, even if you don't live in the US. This week's readings and videos. First video is that Vox video on the gentrification building. Check that out. It's about 8 minutes long. Really great breakdown of it. Second is the deep dive on the Housing Impact Fund. And then third is a historical lesson in zoning laws. So some really cool readings and videos for you this week. Announcements. The International Working Group is open. So you can DM Angelina or Carl. Their Discord names are right there. Also, if you're interested in a science fellowship, our friends at the Atlas Fellowship have their applications open till April 10th. So you can click the link there. I'll also put it in the recap email. And then finally, we have a CU graduation event. Aroth is actually going to come up and tell us a little bit more about it. And Aroth is actually going to be hosting the breakout hangout tonight as well. So Aroth, can you raise your hand and I'll bring you up and you'll tell us a little bit more about the graduation event, and then we'll do Q&A. All right. You're promoted to panelist or off.
Okay. Hello, everyone. So legend says Arad joins every eighth bonfire to announce the fellowship graduation. Yes. So the fellowship graduation is coming and it will happen 1 week after your last bonfire. This is so all juntas wrap up and finish. You still have your juntas. Well, most juntas will still continue their meetings 1 week after the bonfire. So yeah, we will just let them finish. But yeah, yesterday I announced the fellowship graduation committee application. So this committee is in charge of course, organizing the event and planning what should be in the fellowship graduation, what should they include, what should they play. And the applications were just announced yesterday at midnight, I think. Yes. And you can find it in fellow announcements. If not, you can just send me a message. This is the second time in a row we do this. Last time I organized this with five other fellows, and it was a great experience. I deeply encourage you to apply to this committee so you can have at least an introduction to what is events and organization and teams coordination in international teams. It's a pretty cool experience. I definitely recommend it. And well, that's it. I'm not allowed to say something else I was about to say, but you'll find out as time progresses. Sorry. And the fellowship graduation might fall on April 16 or April 17. So please stay tuned for more announcements. And yeah, I think that's everything. So I thank Nick for giving me this 2 minute space. So yeah, if you have questions, please reach out to me.
Of course. Thanks so much for making that announcement. Yeah, please DM Arath if you're interested in doing this. So many fellows have helped create these kind of graduation events, and I know they've gotten a ton out of that. It's a really cool project to work on together for your classmates. So hopefully a bunch of you will get involved. And with that, let's do a little Q&A. If you have any questions about housing innovation, anything we talked about tonight, put your questions in the Q&A in Zoom so they don't get lost in the Discord chat. And we'll stick around for a few minutes to try to answer them if you have any questions. No housing questions. We solved it tonight.
I was like, we can talk about Bruno if everybody wants. No, everyone knows so much. You guys know way more about housing than I did. And the only reason I even learned a lot about it is one, becoming a renter myself. I think the point about education was very important. You have to be informed. If you're not informed, you sign, you know, your rights away, you sign a lot of things away. Houses are, for most Americans, their biggest asset.
All right, we got two quick, all right. The Atlas Fellowship, is it for international fellows? I actually don't know. Check out the link in my recap email tonight and see if they allow international applicants. It's definitely worth checking out. Should the government really be heavily focused on improving housing in huge cities when that will also have the side effect of encouraging more people to the city, just like how building more roads leads to more cars, leads to more traffic? Interesting. You want to, yeah, go ahead, Jess, take that.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think you bring up a good point that we generally should consider, which there are byproducts to everything that we do and all decisions we make, and sometimes they're not obvious. I think the government's first and foremost, job is to provide for its citizens and then take these byproducts you're talking about into account. So I don't think our government should ever engage in any type of large scale project without thinking about what the repercussions are Absolutely. But you know, we have 500,000 homeless people. We definitely need to think through what things we could do to lower that number, which sometimes is different than housing. I think that that's a very fair point. But, you know, regardless of what some things cause, there are symptoms that need to be addressed. It's kind of like the chicken and an egg situation is how I see it.
Yeah, this is an interesting analogy that you drew here, because you're right. It is true that they have proven that building more highways, more lanes actually doesn't relieve congestion. It just encourages more people to drive, more cars on the road and more traffic. I think the difference is, though, there you want to incentivize people to use alternative means for transportation because of like those secondary effects that Drusana is talking about, like an environmental, et cetera. But housing is so essential. Whereas I know some people could argue that driving is essential for people too. But I would say that it's not as essential as housing, and there's no other alternatives to housing besides living in a house or an apartment, in the same way that there's alternatives to transportation. So I think it falls into a little bit separate of a category. But I get what you're saying about encouraging people to move to the city by building housing here. The problem is there's just not enough housing for the people already here. Not even considering people that might attract to those cities.
Right. And they're not leaving.
Exactly. As the fellowship is coming to an end soon, how can a fellow that has graduated still be involved with Civics Unplugged and help? So first thing is helping with graduation. Second thing, as we get towards the end of the fellowship, I'm going to tell you about fellow projects and our steering committee. Our steering committee each term opens up an application for you to propose projects that they would fund. These can be in any number of areas, and the steering committee will go over those. So proposing a project is another way. Watching for opportunities in the Discord. So even when the fellowship ends, you still have access to the Discord and our alumni community there. You'll have access to fellows who have graduated in the past and all the projects they're working on. So there'll be lots and lots of opportunities. We'll also keep having sessions outside of the fellowship. So if you like the systems thinking sessions, those will continue. I'll still be doing sessions on the Supreme Court in April and May and over the summer as big decisions come down. So there's going to be lots of cool ways to stay involved with CU. Just make sure you keep your Discord notifications on, at least in the fellowship announcements channel, and then you'll hear all about what we're doing. All right, here's another question. Do you think this unfairly leads to consequence against the middle class? Like if a homeless person is granted easier access to a home in New York, what about middle-class people who are struggling and just getting by, but not homeless to require immediate government help?
Yeah, so my answer to this is actually most affordable housing isn't for homeless people. It's for the exact people you're talking about who have an income. Like the Housing Impact Fund we looked at is for people who make below median income, but cannot afford housing because it's just so expensive. So there's affordable housing in Brooklyn where I live that's for people who make under $120,000 a year. And homeless housing is even harder to come by than that. So I would say one, I think a lot of people are thinking about the middle class and providing them with affordable housing opportunities. And two, you know, we should walk and chew bubblegum. We should help homeless people, and we should help people who are making below median income as well. It shouldn't be a zero sum. Only one person gets protected and another doesn't.
Right. And the goal, I think, is to try to shepherd someone from homelessness into the middle class eventually, right? It's not to permanently place someone in like a homeless shelter per se, but it's through like a whole set of social services to try to get them to the point where maybe they could be in one of those middle class affordable housing units that we're talking about. I don't think it should be anybody's goal to maintain shelter status for that long. If that's the case though, then it is better than potentially being on the street. Any other questions? All right, I think we'll wrap it up there. Awesome thoughts, questions tonight. Drusana, thank you so much for being here. You are a treasured member of the CU family.
Thank you for having me. Everyone's so smart. I'm gonna look up how.
All right, we'll see you next Monday. Two more bonfires left. Bye, everybody.
Bye, everyone.